Welcome to By the Bywater, a podcast on the Megaphonic Network. I'm Ned Raggett.
I'm Oriana Schwint.
I'm Jared Pekacek.
And we're here to talk about all things J.R.R. Tolkien, his work, his inspirations and impact, creative interpretations in other media, languages, lore, ripoffs, parodies, anything we think is interesting. Thanks for joining us. Hello and welcome to episode 29 of By the Bywater. Great to have you back with us once again. We hope that if you're in the Northern Hemisphere, you're enjoying summer. In the Southern, that you are warm wherever you are. It is not as warm up here as it was last time. That was rather. But it's still summer, so there you go. And all that. We hope, of course, you're well and dealing with things as things get not fully dicey again. But if we again commented on the people out there who are not taking certain shots, well, that would be several hours. So
please, though, seriously, please, if you can get vaccinated, please.
And if you're dealing with people in your life who are not going to, and it's a struggle to get them to do that, we absolutely wish you the best of luck.
We
know
it's
not easy. I'm lucky there. Other people are not so. So, but that out of the way, gosh, even though there's not really much going on, there's a lot going on.
We
found out about literally this morning. So there's plenty to plunge into, and of course, the main topic in a bit. But let's just get right into the news, because boy, we've got some. So please, Jared, go ahead and take it away.
The Amazon production continues to not say much, possibly for the reasons mentioned last time, though a few more actors were confirmed by name as joining the production. That said, the OneRing.net literally just dropped a big spy report the other day, the first in a very long time. It's worth reading in full, and we'll link to it in the show notes, but the site claims to have double-checked with sources confirming just about everything in it. So, okay. Among the notable news is that the Tolkien estate itself is apparently extremely happy with the production, with a number of Tolkien experts of some pedigree, no names were given, on site at one point, while material from the Silmarillion as well as unfinished tales is being drawn on. So shooting security is reconfirmed as being intense, to the point where there's allegedly a fake production unit at work shooting fake footage to throw people off the scent.
Like, what?
Oh my
what?
God.
What?
More
I've
on that
never
later.
Heard of this.
Let's get through this really fast. Two creative choices of note. First, there's supposed to be darker skinned, quote, early halflings appearing in the series, with UK actor Lenny Henry apparently playing one of them, while there will appear to be footage showing captured elves being corrupted and turned into orcs, with the spy report language noting some nudity here and commenting it will have a, quote, concentration camp type visuals, end quote, which is, you know, pretty loaded. And finally, Sauron himself in whatever form is not said to appear in the first season.
So we'll see. You know, our casting guesses are wrong for now, apparently.
Mm-hmm.
But where to begin with?
Here.
Yeah, but where to begin with all this? Yeah, where to begin? I mean, that's a lot of. If even part of that is true about the you know, is concentration camp visuals just something grabbed on in a desperate attempt to try and describe something, or what? Because
I'm going to guess yes, because I can't imagine if the Tolkien estate is happy with what they've seen thus far, which is actually like something that you know, whether they love it or not, I don't particularly care all that much. But I think I just screwed myself out of like getting the Silmarillion rights from them.
Well, you take your money, you take your choice.
Damn.
There you go.
Yeah, I can't imagine they would be super jazzed about something that even appears to be sort of directly a World War II type allegory. Even if it's just imagery that happens to. Why are they even showing the orcs' origins? That's what I'm curious about. Is it just a little flashback?
Yeah, I mean,
and what origin story?
Right?
There's a couple of them.
Shout out to our episode. I can't remember the episode number, but we did do one not that long ago about the orcs and their origins and how Tolkien radically rethought those origins. Not that long after, you know, The Lord of the Rings came out. It does seem as though they might be going with the, like, you know, elves tortured by Morgoth into becoming orcs, which is interesting.
It is for sure. And some of the other details that were given in the report, there's a lot we didn't touch on, although some of it is, you know, just sort of smaller. I mean, the fake production unit thing,
I've never heard of that, but, or I guess, I know there were, like, fake scripts for sides. That's, like, you know, been happening for a long, long time in lots of productions. But That's crazy.
I mean,
that's crazy.
I mean, is it something where they're just considering it potential B-roll footage for the heck of it, which would make at least a little more sense? Like, okay, we just fill it out in the corners, we're not really going to care about it as much. I could sort of half see that. But going to that effect, I mean, it's one thing to do famously what Star Wars did back in the early 80s when they were shooting Return of the Jedi, and they were shooting the sequence out in the, I think it was the Mojave Desert, but somewhere in California, and legendarily the production was called Blue Harvest. It was supposed to be some sort of SF horror story, and they just left it at that. And of course, some true fans did sniff it out because, you know, why wouldn't they? There will always be spy reports. But that's covering an actual production where everyone knows what's going on. And yeah, you know, the Jackson Lord of the Rings production was called Jamboree because it's supposed to be a reference to a Boy Scout Jamboree. I mean, these are just things that are out there. But to create a fully separate unit with gear, I mean, you can't, if you're going to do a full production unit, you're actually committing time, money, and people. And what is going on? I mean, does Jeff Bezos have that much money?
I guess yes. Like, yes, it wouldn't surprise me if he were personally funding, like, part of this instead of ending world hunger or homelessness. You know,
he's doing everything but that.
Yay.
Oh my gosh. Speaking of allegory, but that is. Like, well, and I also don't understand why, like, you are, you know, you are not actually going to suffer financially if there is footage leaked or character descriptions leaked or even casting leaked. Like, that actually only works for the better, like, I don't know, it creates buzz. In that case, like, all press is good press, I think, and it's bizarre to me.
It's not a freaking CIA wet site or anything. It's
or isn't it? That's what the, oh my god, it's not actually elves being turned into orcs.
Oh god. Yeah, it's like, there's no reason to keep, I mean, even the level of secrecy that we already knew that they had, there's no reason for it. And if this is true, then it's like, this is just, you're just throwing money around because you can.
Right?
Yeah, I know.
Give it to me. Give me the money.
It'd be great if there was some whole other production out there, you know, things like that. But, I mean,
You could feed entire countries on what they're spending on this show anyway, and then they go and do this.
Their argument will be that they're feeding New Zealanders, so there you go. So, you know, the tourism industry went down. They needed something. I mean, you know, who knows? I mean, there's lots of other stuff in the spy report, and by all means, take some time to read through it all. There's some hilarious details about, like, how accessing scripts and what's been shot and done and things like that, sort of confirming some of the other details that we reported on last time. They're aiming for apparently, allegedly, a mid-2022 release. That fits the timeline that was offered last time. It also indicates there was one interesting detail. We did find out what one of the actors is actually playing, because Tom Budge was let go from the production. He announced his departure, and apparently he was playing Celebrimbor, which is interesting because that's obviously got to be a major role.
Yeah.
And if they had shot the whole thing and then let him go after that, it's like, ooh, that's some sunk cost, actually. So it's sort of,
Or did he just not announce that until well after he had left? Like, it's just a weird,
yeah, it could be.
Who knows what time things are happening?
Right. This is entirely true. Yeah. So contracts can say what they will. So we might find out more, we might not. But there's a huge info dump. We will hopefully find out more soon. But there is something actually directly Tolkien related. So Oriana, if you want to talk about that.
Yeah, so on the book front, or audiobook front, as it is, so after having released Andy Serkis's reading of The Hobbit last year, HarperCollins will be releasing Serkis returning to this role with an unabridged reading of the entirety of The Lord of the Rings. We don't have fully clear release dates yet, but all three books are up for pre-order, with a tweet from HarperCollins indicating that Fellowship will be released in September, presumably with the other two following soon after that, if not immediately after. So this is the first authorized read-through of the book since Rob Inglis's somewhat stately version back in the 1980s. So it'll be interesting to see what choices Serkis brings to the many characters in these books. It's interesting.
I hope he does just like an entirely different Gollum voice.
Yeah, that would be.
Yeah, I mean, the Hobbit's out there, so I mean, you know, we already got a sense of what he's doing it now. I'm that would be great if it was just some sort of, like, you know, greasy wheeler dealer. Hey, how you doing? You know, things
like that. So,
hey,
precious.
Yeah. And if he gave all the cast members completely different readings than what they got in the films or things like that, you know, just sort of like
I mean, why not? Why not?
Creative interpretation, but it'll be interesting. My guess is he will try and, you know, do his best to find his own spin on these things, because that makes a good thing as opposed to just simply trying to recreate a film or anything like that, which would be rather boring. So we will see. But Rob Inglis's recitation, perfectly fine, but kind of like the BBC radio production of its time. It'll be interesting to see what this one will be like for sure. Nothing else really news-wise to report, although I literally, just before we started recording, I noticed a foreign policy piece, as in the publication, called, what's the name of it? Literally ran yesterday, called Comrades of the Ring, subtitle How Soviet Artists Evaded Censors to Create Their Own Visions of Tolkien. Looks pretty interesting. We'll link it in the show notes. Could be worth a read just for some detail there. That's all we have for major news right now, so let's simply go right into it, to the main topic. It is Oriana's choice of topic, so please do take it away.
The eagles are coming. So a little while back, I guess it was like, I don't know, May or so, there was some capital D discourse about a rather misleading tweet that Polygon put out. So the tweet says, "The eagles in Lord of the Rings are a plot hole, but also an us problem, a final word on a never-ending debate." Now, it was so misleading because the article itself is mostly about why the eagles are not actually a plot hole in the Lord of the Rings movies or book. So I mostly want to talk about how I agree with that and why, but also why it's something that, like, why do we even insist on talking about this, so many years later, and whether that was a complaint that Tolkien had to deal with in his own time. So the first published mention of the eagles, with a capital E always, in the published Tolkien legendarium is in The Hobbit. Of course, the unnamed Lord of the Eagles and his folk are sitting in their eyries, and they notice the goblins making a racket, and so they come down to sort of spoil the orcs' fun. Very same eagles turn up at the end of the book to cause further harm to the orcs, though the tide of the battle doesn't turn solely on their appearance. Battle ends, the unnamed Lord of the Eagles is given gold by the very thankful dwarves. Hooray. And, you know, in the Lord of the Rings proper, of course, we have Gwaihir, the Wind Lord, who rescues Gandalf from the top of Orthanc, rescues him again from the top of Caradhras. So, God, I said that better in my mind. anyway, the top of the big mountain.
The Red Horn.
The Red Horn. Thank you. And then at the end is specifically asked by Gandalf to take a couple bros over to the ruins of Mount Doom and rescue Frodo and Sam if they can. In the first age, we have the eagles flying Húrin and Hor to Gondolin, but otherwise they're mostly just sort of messengers from the Valar. The concept of the eagles is once again not super settled in the quote-unquote lore, I suppose. This is yet another instance in which we see Tolkien trying to figure out the nature of life itself in Middle-earth and the question of who counts as a sentient being. The original king of the eagles in the first age is Thorondor, and he's generally considered to be one of the Maiar, sort of angelic beings, and they can't really reproduce, minus Melian. We don't really get a whole lot of that. But Gwaihir and Landreval, who appear in The Lord of the Rings, are considered to be descendants of Thorondor. So Tolkien is, once again, trying to figure all this out in his notes. And this is from Morgoth's Ring, the big volume, where, you know, he's writing, quote, "Would Eru provide fear for such creatures? For the eagles, etc., perhaps, but not for orcs," he says. The eagles were, quote, "taught language by the Valar and raised to a higher level, but they still had no fear." But we don't really get any real conclusion here. But they are just big birds. whether or not they have souls or animating consciousnesses, they're big birds. and they work for good. Great. While it's kind of unclear whether Tolkien had to actually deal with the idea of the eagles as a quote-unquote pothole, as a quote-unquote plot hole in real life, he definitely hated a 1958 attempt to adapt The Lord of the Rings into an animated film. And this treatment was like kind of silly with eagles. And Tolkien, boy, did he not like that. Quote, "The eagles are a dangerous machine," he wrote in his response to the treatment. "I have used them sparingly, and that is the absolute limit of their credibility or usefulness." Tolkien Gateway claims that Tolkien also said in this letter, it's letter 210, that the eagles, quote, "are not taxis." I did not see that in my copy. I don't know if either of you guys, I just couldn't, it wasn't in there. Maybe it was, right? You would think that would really stick out. The writer of the treatment for this movie was Morton Grady Zimmerman, and he proposed having the eagles come to Rivendell and basically fly the nine walkers into the Misty Mountains, and I'm guessing to the Redhorn Pass. And Tolkien likens it to having a helicopter ferry people halfway up Everest. Does this count as a plot hole that the eagles do not simply fly Sam and Frodo over to Mount Doom? Obviously not. There are so many reasons why it would be a bad idea to have like one eagle flying Frodo and Sam to Mordor. Mostly like the Nazgul have their own winged beasts, and an aerial approach would attract a lot more attention. It would probably be more expected by the enemy. And it's just bad storytelling because the journey is the point here. Getting this kind of brief time, all told, with all nine walkers together is the point. Frodo having to make the heartbreaking decision to break off from the Fellowship is the point. And yet we keep seeing this question pop up. Now, did you guys at any point have to have this argument with someone, either online or in real life? And do you believe that it was a sincerely asked question or simply someone just trying to get you mad?
That's good. Jared, do you want to start with that one? I'm sort of not sure.
I've never had anybody ask it. I've definitely seen it come up. Mm-hmm. And every time I have about 10 seconds of going, someone's wrong on the internet.
Yeah.
I've got to correct this.
Yeah.
But then.
Link in the show notes if you don't know that one.
But then I'm like, is this how I want to spend my one wild and precious life?
Right.
Is arguing about the eagles online.
Right. True.
I feel like when people ask this question, I don't think it's necessary. It can be an attempt to irritate somebody, because you could definitely clearly irritate at least three people with this question. But I think part of it is people misunderstanding what a story is, like what a plot is, as if it's only a, like as if a clock is just the gears and not the time that it tells.
Mm-hmm.
So, that was good. Proud of that. Anyway,
rightly.
Yeah, like a lot of people now, I think maybe because of sins or something, think that like if something doesn't mesh or doesn't appear to mesh, or is even the slightest way out of whack with something else, that it's now an error, a plot hole.
Yeah.
And really, it's just there are more important things happening.
Mm-hmm.
So
in my case, I was just thinking about this just now. I should have gone ahead and done some rereading of some of the original criticism that's out there, negative of Lord of the Rings, to see if it was brought up there. I can't recall if Edmund Wilson in his famous slam of it brings it up or not. Seems like something he would do since he didn't like anything about it. More fool him, but that's another matter. But I can say that it was definitely something that was, you could say, in the water by a certain point, because in the late 60s, when the Harvard Lampoon, because it was still the Harvard Lampoon at the point, released its parody Board of the Rings, which is still in print and is very much a late 60s snapshot. You can tell it's the time, the references, the jokes are all of the time that it was written. For better or for worse, you get an idea of what was going on there. There is a very specific joke about the eagles. Basically, when, I forget the fake name they give Gwaihir in that one, but it's sort of like our Dildo and Sam equivalents. I won't bother with the names. It's ridiculous and childish and stupid, and that's why they work. But anyway, so they're there at the Mountain Doom equivalent there, being picked up by Gwaihir, flies in and basically says, he basically comes in like looking like a plane or something. He says he's running Deus Ex Machina Airlines. So, you know, so clearly the idea of sort of like, hey, the Eagles get him out of a jam, and Deus Ex Machina, we'll link that if you don't know that concept. But again, it's the idea of, you know, the God in the machine, the fix that's sort of like, oh, our heroes are in trouble, but here comes something miraculous to save them, you know. So this idea of the Eagles functioning as that in something that was not critical response, but clearly something of the discourse of responding to looking at the novel and going like, hey, what about this, is played around with. Encountering it since then, I don't know. Frankly, for me, it was one of those things that when it was first advanced, and I think maybe reading Lord of the Rings back in the mid-80s, was sometime after reading Lord of the Rings, of course, was the first time I got a sense of that. It was almost sort of like I didn't notice it until it was pointed out.
Yeah.
That's really what it boils down to.
I never considered in my first like couple readings of the books that this was really an option. It just seemed very obvious given the Nazgul riding their fell beasts. It's like, well, yeah, of course, giant, you know, even one giant eagle is gonna attract a lot of attention.
you're flying into Mordor. The eagles doing anything is notable, of course they're gonna notice them. But I mean, like, this just the justification of like, of course they would notice an airstrike is like, that didn't even occur to me either when it was just like, this is what the Eagles do, is occasionally, very occasionally, they show up and help out in ultimately a kind of minor way.
Yes, that is the key. That is why I will never agree that they are any sort of deus ex machina.
Yeah, like, they don't solve the plot.
Exactly. They, you know, the plot is finished by the time Frodo and Sam are about to be Pompeyed. So, you know, whether Frodo and Sam actually live or die is actually, I'm not going to say it's inconsequential, but like, you know, the Eagles could have been any other thing. And I don't know, it just doesn't matter to me.
I think it's more interesting to note that, if anything, where the Eagles function more as a clear deus ex machina, you could argue, if you want to go that far, isn't Lord of the Rings at all, it's the Hobbit.
Yeah.
Because the idea is that it seems like the forces of good are about to lose to the orcs. That's the impression that Bilbo gets as he's waiting with Gandalf. And, you know, even Gandalf seems like he's like, oh, well, it's come to this. But then it's like, you know, says, hey, the Eagles are coming, and everyone takes a call, and then he gets knocked out, and we hear about it afterwards that it was, you know, apparently a great help. And then, although it, ultimately Beorn is supposed to be the tide turner, you know, in the end there. So, but we saw that was solved in the movies. Anyway, never mind.
No, we will be. We will talk about that weird adaptational choice.
I do not remember whatever you're talking about. I probably blocked it out.
One of the Eagles brings Beorn along and drops him, and he transforms into a bear halfway down as he plunges. That's
okay. No joke.
The way that's said, I do sort of love that.
The way it's done, you may have other ideas.
The execution is poor, let's say. And it is just, it's so weird. Because, like, in the Hobbit text, it's just like, oh, Bjorn's here. Interesting, huh? Where did he come from? And, like, it's not explained because, honestly, who cares? But then I still don't recall having actually seen the third Hobbit movie. I must have, because I have memories of certain scenes.
They just have
one of the Eagles just like parachuting Bjorn in and dropping him like a bomb, like a bear bomb, onto the evil forces. And it's what a completely bizarre.
Just wait until we do our episode talking about this thing. Imagine all this bile concentrated. God. It'll be good. But if I can turn it.
Turn back. Sorry.
No,
sorry.
I'll turn
tangent.
It back, because let's go back to, as you say, when they were first introduced in the Legendarium, that's the Hobbit, which is interesting because that's the most we get out of Gwaihir as a speaking character.
Yeah.
And I think everything that you brought up, Oriana, is kind of mentioned there. We do get a sense that they're only really tangentially involved, and they're only doing this just because of certain key bits of circumstances. But I like the portrait of the Eagles as they're introduced. Like, we meet them, basically, the camera pulls away to pull the movie thing, but more or less the perspective changes. You know, we've been following along with Bilbo and the Hobbits. All of a sudden, we're now shifting completely entirely beyond Bilbo's own perspective. I think, essentially, for the first time in the entire story, and we go to a decentered spot where we're up with the Eagles.
Yeah.
And that first discussion is like Gwaihir just chilling out somewhere in his ear going like, what's all the noise?
What is all this hullabaloo?
Yeah. Which is lovely. I actually love that.
Very relatable. Yeah. Very relatable.
You get this idea of like, you know, some noble lord going like, the peasants are revolting. Yes, lord. And, you know, but in this case, it's like, what's going on down there? You know, I like that because it's a very abstruse form of humor, but it also seems to fit. You get a sense of a very, you know, very stately, lordly figure. His language is very, you know, it's not casual. He's, you know, Gwaihir speaks with a certain form of intent in that sequence. You do get a sense that, of course, he's the Lord of the Eagles. He sounds like a lord. And the way he acts is very lordly, but very, very prideful. Incredibly prideful. And basically, everybody is sort of treated as, you know, I'm doing you a favor. Gandalf may be the exception, and that's only because Gandalf healed. The explanation is that Gandalf healed Gwaihir from a wound at some point. That's why it's done. But I like that characterization. There's nothing quite like that, I would argue, in the Legendarium necessarily. You could argue the elves to a degree, but I think the eagles sort of have their own intangible character, and which is interesting because, again, we get most of it in The Hobbit. We certainly don't get most of it in Lord of the Rings.
Yeah, it is, you know, it's the talking animal kind of problem where it is like clearly they are beasts, but they are able to speak, or some of them at least are able to speak. It also, you kind of wonder about eagle society a bit. What is, you know, they have a lord. So they have, like, who taught them to have lords? Was it the Valar teaching them to speak and also being like, here is our society.
You need a king.
You need a king. Everyone needs a king. Tolkien in a nutshell.
Yeah. Both the hobbits.
But yeah, it is odd to think about like eagle society and what are the norms of eagle society?
Well, maybe that draws something of the fact that, you know, you sort of touched on this, you know, what are the origins of the eagles? What is their, you know, where does this species come from? Is like the nearest parallel something the fact that the giant spiders that we can say of Mirkwood and, of course, Shelob, you know, descended from Ungoliant in some way? Is that a similar thing with Thorondor and then this right here? Are they supposed to be not lesser versions of these earlier eagles, but more incarnate versions, or
kind of thorny to think about?
Yeah.
There's some interesting parallels, I think, between the eagles and various evil flying creatures. Like, you know, the eagles may or may not be Maiar, who knows, sort of, maybe they're messengers of Manwë, whatever. And then Morgoth goes and creates the dragons, but explicitly like makes them and gets evil spirits to inhabit them and all that. So like they're dark eagles, I don't know. And then later in Lord of the Rings, Sauron makes the, you know, the fell beasts or whatever they're called, almost in opposition to the eagles in a sense. So this is that old Tolkien opposition between like natural creation and then like perversion
this,
of it, you know, whatever, like
you,
making the evil version of something because you can't, for whatever reason, create an original. You can't have an original thought if you're evil. You're just making bad stuff.
Yeah.
Nothing but a bad photocopy.
Yeah. You can't make, you can only mock.
Yeah.
Maybe to step back a bit, to step outside of Middle Earth, just to talk about eagles in human societies, because they certainly, you know, when Tolkien had the eagles create these things, he's obviously drawing on a grand tradition of seeing the eagles as some of the most majestic, you know, creatures, you know, in history, who have been invoked and used in many different ways. I mean, I'm going to be explicitly focusing on a more familiar strand here, but in Greco-Roman mythology and imagery, it's massive. The idea that eagles, that there, if I remember right, there's a particular eagle that's a servant of Zeus up in Olympus, since things like that, and there are other things. Famously, of course, the eagles were represented in Roman culture very heavily. There's the very famous, possibly apocryphal, but still notable line that the legions of the Roman armies were represented by eagles by their standards. And so the idea of the eagle as, you know, and in America, what, bald eagles again? You know, Ben Franklin may have wanted the turkey, but we got the bald eagles. So I mean, this,
I was gonna say,
yeah, you know, this cascades down. This idea of this sort of, it's an apex predator. It is seen to be seem to be someone of, you know, up the air, up high. There's eagles versus hawks versus other things, you know, these predator levels, you know, go and thing, but they are seen to be something, you know, pretty majestically terrifying, really, is what they are, especially especially with such a large size. So the choice of the eagle is incredibly intentional by Tolkien. I mean, he's drawing on something, and maybe there's more to it than that, but it's how he uses this impact, you could say, in humanity's, you know, assumptions of what the eagle, the imagery is like, and using that makes it interesting. How does he make it his own? And so plunging maybe back into the legendarium from there. So
yeah, I mean, by making them Manwë servants, he's really working in that Indo-European mythological tradition where the, you know, historically the reconstructed religion of all Indo-European peoples. Sorry, what am I doing right now? I'm sorry, everybody. Anyway,
no, we love it.
Yeah,
we
please
love
go
it.
On.
There's the pantheon is headed by a sky father, and I think Odin maybe participates in that tradition, and Odin is associated with birds, specifically ravens. But there's an eagle that sits on top of Yggdrasil and all that.
That's
and
right.
Like Zeus has the eagles. It's he's, you know, making a mythology for Britain and all that, and in doing so he's tying it into a very specific world mythological tradition, and not just human societies in general, but like specifically derived from this one shared root, which, you know, he was a linguist, he would have known what people were doing and reconstructing Indo-European languages and all that, and the words, like, we know that they had a sky father deity and a dawn goddess deity and all that, because languages that descend from this root have very similar names for this deity. Like Zeus is derived from something like deus pater, you know, the father god, and Jupiter is from the same root and all that. Anyway, I feel like there's a potential that it's an in-joke in that sense. maybe joke is the wrong word, but just like a very specific reference to this old tradition.
Definitely of a piece. If you are creating this sort of mythological backing for a, you know, Northern European British story, it makes sense that you would pull from that. And can't go wrong with the classic, like, eagles, they get really big and they fly, sky god. I mean, hello. It just, it fits very neatly.
There's something about how they appear in the Silmarillion. You brought them up briefly in your introduction, Oriana. There's something very loaded about how they appear in essentially what final version of the Gondolin story we get, which, of course, as we've talked about, is something that was originally written early on and only barely touched from that point since. But there is the sense that the reason why they were burying Hurin and Hur in the first place is they're said to live in the Chrysiagrim, the mountains around Gondolin. And that's where Thorondor and everyone are supposed to hang around. Although there is the variant story that indicates they were supposed to actually live on Thangorodrim of a time.
Yeah.
Which is one of those interesting variants, because then the question was like, wait, was Thangorodrim already there? Again, unsettled. There's all sorts of, you know, the idea is, are the eagles keeping watch on what's going on there? You know, that's something to unpack. But what's interesting is this. They act as a, you know, over, you know, guardian sky force, you could say, reporting back as sort of like if they see things going on, because they're the eagles. They can see everything. And there is clearly an understanding between Turgon and the Gondolindrim and the eagles to some degree. But it's notable how they don't participate. And a good example is the fall of Gondolin, which basically everything happens. This invasion force comes, takes it all over. But the eagles don't really show up, to my memory, correct me if I'm wrong, I could be wrong, until there's the battle between Glorfindel, the original one, and the Balrog. And Thorondor comes down and takes up Glorfindel's corpse from where it's fallen down the thing. It's sort of like, well, I'm glad you noticed that, buddy. Where have you been the whole time? People are being slaughtered. What's going on?
Well, there's a sort of, because of the way the eagles function as messengers of the Valar and so forth, there's a sense, at least for me, that when they show up, it's a kind of a mark of divine favor. And at that point, the Gondolindrim are like, you know, screw you, we're staying here, even though they've been sent very clear warnings by Ulmo, who's like, you got to get out of here. So it's not, I don't think it's like literally that they're not showing up because, you know, the Gondolin has defied the will of the gods or whatever. I think it's symbolically they're rescuing this sort of righteous remnant, but the rest of them who were arrogant are like kind of beyond their help by choice.
And it is, we can cut this out if I'm wrong, but doesn't like an eagle take thing on up to...
To rescue Mithros?
Yes. Okay, yeah. Great.
Yeah, you got it right. I think it's meant to be Thorondor. And Thorondor also appears when Fingolfin calls out Morgoth.
Yeah.
He mars his face.
Morgoth is about to completely destroy Fingolfin's body. Thorondor swoops in the last minute and goes like, ha-ha, and things like this, and reclaims Fingolfin's body for proper burial.
So. But also, it does not help earlier.
No.
Right.
No.
Because the Noldor are getting punished.
Clean up, almost. Yeah. Like, all right, clean up on aisle, Angband.
Yeah,
like,
I was going to say that.
No.
When Superstore meets Morgoth, I can see it now.
Amazing. No. But yeah, there is they help, like, they're always around to do kind of the bare minimum.
Mm-hmm. That was so funny to me.
Kind of the bare minimum. Wow. You know, normally we don't predict our episode titles, but I think we just got one, so there you go.
Yes. But yeah, you know, they're not a taxi service, but they are there to, like, I'll take you, like, just... They're like the new Metro Micro LA public transit option, which is like a ride share type thing that only takes you, to places within like a certain range. And after that, and it ends at 9:30 at night. So that's the Eagles
are
for
the
you.
LA Metro Transit system.
We all search for metaphors in our own lives. here's a small factor of how the Eagles function in a way that's really intriguingly mystical is not the word, but very, very notably, like, very not of this earth. I think it's very interesting where and how they function, and that's in Numenor.
Mm. Oh, yeah.
Because they function in, there's two different very key ways they do. First, as is mentioned in the Eldarion and Rendus material, and the description of Numenor along with that, is that the very peak of the Menal Tarma are supposed to be three eagles who basically keep an eye on things. And by saying keep an eye on things, they really don't like you up there. They're sort of like, if you try and approach, they'll swoop down from wherever they've been and be like, yes. And they're not said to say anything, but they're basically sort of enforcing the hallowedness of the ground.
Yeah.
And the only time anyone is up there are the three festivals during the year where everyone comes up there and nobody speaks with the exception of the ruling monarch. That's the only person who actually speaks there. And the eagles at that point fly above in a circle, like almost like, you know, divine favor. So it's this interesting sort of thing. And there's also meant to be related to that. There are the eagles that are supposed to be kept in the house of the king. And they're always they're kept there in support. There's always a couple of eagles, if I remember right, that are supposed to be there in Armenelos. And then when everything goes wrong, the eagles, you know, from the Temple of Menal Tarma, they don't seem to go away. The eagles that are kept in the Armenelos are supposed to be gone, but they do appear in one very more dramatic fashion, and that is as a symbol. That is the symbol of in the West as the big fleet is coming together. This vast shape of an eagle, like a cloud shaped like an eagle, sort of like basically like, hi, here's Doom, and it's sort of like, you know, everyone's like, you know, and the idea is that the king's men in Armenelos are like, yes, you know, we'll fight this back. And there's a Ted Naismith illustration of that, and Naismith's art is, you know, it works on, you know, for his folks, but I thought that was one of his better ones, just showing this, you know, just awesome figure, just, you know, in the sky off in the distance. It's like, you know, it's like a literal wrath of God. So
yeah. That part's so funny because the Numenorean, it's a regular, after a certain point, it's a regular occurrence, these, like, eagle clouds showing up and, like, shooting lightning from their wings and all that. Mm. And the Numenoreans are like, this is fine. We can deal with this.
Oh, draw modern parallels as you like there, Jared.
Well, me? Never.
Ooh. So, but yeah, you're right about that. One thing I'll bring up, and maybe this will be the last thing I bring up. I mean, it's your topic, Ariana, so you can take it many different ways, is I like how in The Hobbit we do get a sense of their sense of humor. Because these eagles are funny. It ties in with this arch nobility they have, because they're sort of like, you know, Bilbo was holding on too tight and is sort of like, you need not squeeze like, you know, things like that. You know, don't do that. Yeah. And then there's all this other, you know, just wonderful trash talking. And one of the best lines, I think it's from Gwaihir talking about, if it's not Gwaihir, it's one of the other, goes like, where they're going to drop them off, where they're going to take them. And he says like, yeah, we can't go to the south because, you know, that's where the men dwell. And the line is something like, they would shoot shoot at us with their great bows of yew. And they were thinking that'd be sometimes down there, you know, to steal their cattle or whatever. And then he adding, and sometimes they would be right. And that is actually a really good way to sort of like, again, capturing what they are. They don't care about human society as much. They don't really care about all that. And, you know, we see it in The Lord of the Rings when you see it briefly. When Gwaihir were ready to choose Gandalf, who, after all, is not mankind, is something like this. It's like, you know, where can you take me? Oh, I can take you far. Not to the end of the world, but I can take you far. Mm-hmm. It's like, thanks, buddy.
Right. Even with the fondness that Gwaihir has for Gandalf, like, even he is like, I mean, not too crazy. Let's not go, you know, I'm not taking you to LAX at rush hour here. Like,
nobody would.
I'm going to have to do that with a friend who's coming to visit, and I'm in like months, and I'm already dreading it.
Side note, flying in out of Burbank, that's the way to go.
I know. But yeah, the Eagles, they're great. And they are not taxis. I do wish that Tolkien had wrote that line, but I could not find it.
The thing is, I have the weirdest memory of reading that, and I couldn't find it in that letter, but I know he said something very much like it.
Similar, so I'm not sure. Maybe we can just all pretend. Maybe, is it the Mandela effect here somehow? Did we all read it on Tolkien Gateway, and now it's just...
Now we just assume that it's
that's
true.
That's just it, yeah.
Totally said it, yeah. He typed it out on the internet, you know, back in 1945. He clearly did that.
You know, totally. Yeah, I feel like... That was kind of, this was like sort of a bit of a lighter topic. Yeah. That was my...
I do have to say, I think it's very funny that when he does, people ask him about the Eagles or whatever, his justification for not doing certain things with them is never anything that we've brought up. It's always this inner, like, internal logic of like, well, they're the messengers of God, so of course you can't expect them to do this. When that's like, that's not in Lord of the Rings. You don't see that show up at all. That's not mentioned. So when people are like, well, why aren't they doing this? And he's going, well, they're the servants of the elder king of the world. Like, dude, nobody knows that except you.
It kind of fits in, though, with what he is that, you know, he doesn't explain everything.
Or when he does explain everything, it's still...
It's still, like,
only on his own terms.
Absolutely. That actually is one thing, like, reading through, so the letter 210 that we've been discussing in this episode is very much about, you know, the treatment of the movie that didn't end up getting made, and it did make, a lot of these notes were very, I was like, oh, he would have hated the Peter Jackson movies, just because there are certain things in there, like Aragorn having a sword before reaching Rivendell and, you know, the attack on Weathertop. I think he would have hated it. But it did make me wonder, you know, is there any adaptation? And we're straying from the Eagles, but that's fine. It does make me wonder, is there any adaptation he would have been satisfied with? And I think the answer is no.
I don't think so. Especially, I think one of his objections in the letter specifically has to do with the timeline that they put forward. And he's like, well, Gandalf was gone for 2 months or whatever. I forget what it was. And it was like, dude, you can't. It's a movie. You can't do everything exactly the way it is on the page. Like, how are you even... That's not information that anybody really needs to know. Yeah. It's not... Yeah. Come on! So, yeah, I don't think there is an adaptation that would have pleased him unless it was, like, a 12-hour prestige miniseries or something. And even then...
Even then.
Right? any sort of change would have been just...
Yeah, well, you can't do it because of this. And it's like, come on. But we have to.
It's a different medium, man. I know.
Some of the stuff that he says about adaptation is totally fair.
Absolutely.
Like, if you're missing the point of what, I don't know, Rivendell is calling it a forest or something when it's actually like a house. It's, you know,
that's kind of like a
fairy
castle.
Why would you make that change? I think that same adaptation was like, Rivendell is a forest and Lothlorien is a fairy castle. And it's like, no, those are very basic things to get wrong here. And there's no reason why you would swamp them.
Right.
But yeah.
But at least eagles.
But eagles, they're fun and they're not a plot hole. It does make me wonder what people think a plot hole actually is.
Yeah, there's a weird fuzziness to that term when I see it used sometimes.
It doesn't make sense to me. To me, a plot hole is the writer of the story, whatever medium it is, the final form is, the writer of the story has omitted a piece of the story, and therefore it's not being conveyed to the recipients of the story, and therefore there is like this leap in logic or internal logic. To me, that is a plot hole. They do exist, but so many people are just like, but I would have done this differently.
Yeah, and that makes it a plot hole.
Yeah.
Yeah, like in Lord of the Rings, I guess a plot hole wouldn't be, you know, it's not the eagles not taking them everywhere, because of course they wouldn't. It's like, you know, you hear about the ring as a corrupting influence and all that, and then suddenly at the end somebody's able to use it with no ill effects.
Yeah,
like that would be exactly. Kind of a plot hole. Like it violates the established laws of the story. Mm. The eagles not being your personal taxi service does not violate the logic of the story.
In some, the eagles are not your friend.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That is funny, though. They're, I mean, so close to the end and swerving back now. They're weird, like, not antipathy, but they have their own moral code that they're following.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They may be on the good side, but they're not friendly.
No.
No.
It's, and that's, you know, oh, Tolkien's
kind of like
just good
ants.
And evil. And it's like, no, they are doing their own thing. Yeah,
yeah.
Like the ants.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we're now looking ahead to the next episode here. That is Jared's choice of topic. So what are we talking about, Jared?
Yeah, well, so I actually thought of this independently of everything that's come up. But then after 5 seconds, I was like, actually, this is a nice little, flows nicely. We've talked about the Children of Húrin, which is one of the big three stories. And we've talked about the eagles. So let's tackle the second, and I think oldest, of the big three, which is the Fall of Gondolin.
Oh, okay.
Yay!
Well, yeah.
Yeah. Mm. It's such a significant part of the thing, and we need to do an episode about it.
And Tuor, Oriana's favorite
yeah,
character.
That
yeah,
guy.
My favorite guy. It is. There's so much to talk about there, though. That's great.
Yeah, yeah.
It is.
It is such a foundational story, and we did mention it. So yeah, we will plunge right into that.
I should probably put this in my introduction for the actual episode, but like, this is one of the major things for me that I love about Lord of the Rings. Like a lot of people, I think, especially Tolkien, is like, oh, Beren Lúthien, the foundational like romance or whatever. And I'm like, this city's so cool. It's an elf city in the mountains. It's so amazing. Like. That's what I get excited about.
It was it this or Húrin where Tolkien wrote like 20,000 lines an epic poem.
I think it was Húrin.
And then abandoned it.
Húrin, yeah. I don't think he
okay,
did.
Okay.
He never did write a poetic form of this story to my knowledge.
Okay,
but,
okay.
But that's for next time. That's for next time.
Yes,
let's wrap it up there. So you'll know what we'll be talking about in a month or so. So thank you as always very much for listening. As always, our contact info is in our outro. So anything you want to let us know about, please do. Keep listening, contribute to our Patreon, the Megaphonic one if you can, that'd be lovely. And we will see you all in a month's time, and we will be talking, you know, Gondolin and all sorts of things besides. And Tuor, who again is just a guy. So until that time, we'll see you. Thanks very much. Thanks again for listening to this episode of By the Bywater. Please subscribe and rate us via your favorite podcast listening options.
Episodes and show notes are at megaphonic.fm/bythebywater, all one word. You can also message us through here. Email us at bythebywater@megaphonic.fm or follow us on Twitter @bythebywater.
You can also follow us individually on Twitter and ask questions there. I'm @VandroidHelsing.
I'm @Schwinter, SCHWINDTER.
And I'm Ned Raggett, 2 G's, 2 T's. By the Bywater is a proud member of Megaphonic Podcast Network. Find all our fancy little shows at megaphonic.fm. We hope you join us again next time. Until then, Namarie.